Ja, einen schönen guten Abend und herzlich willkommen hier im Kino des Deutschen Filmmuseums. Vielen Dank fürs Warten zunächst mal, aber ich denke, es wird sich gelohnt haben, denn Sie werden heute einen ganz spannenden Vortrag über Paris im Film sehen von Isabel McNeil, die heute unser Gast ist. Dafür schon mal vielen Dank. Gleich switchen wir auch ins Englische dementsprechend, wie Sie schon am Namen hören. Zunächst einmal, wir sind wieder hier. Agnès Varda war jetzt zweimal hier zu Gast. Wir sind unglaublich glücklich und stolz gewesen, das miterlebt haben zu dürfen. Ja, und jetzt geht's weiter. Wir wollen uns weiterhin beschäftigen mit den Hintergründen ihres Werkes, mit den Selbstporträts von anderen, was unserer Lecture-Reihe übersteht. Wie immer gibt es auch Begleitprogramme zu dieser Reihe und das ist im Mai tatsächlich etwas größer geartet, nämlich eine ganze Monatsreihe, die wir immer thematisch festlegen, und zwar Paris im Film wird dann eines der Themen sein, dass wir heute eben auch mit Kurzfilm von Agnès Varda haben und dann in der kompletten Filmgeschichte von Marcel Carnet bis in die Gegenwart. Ich möchte gar nicht mehr viel sagen, weil wir sind in Verzug, deswegen bitte begrüßen Sie Vincent Zediger und anschließend viel Vergnügen mit Isabel McNeil. Viel Spaß.
Yeah, I'll be brief. When Agnès Varda was here in Frankfurt 2 weeks ago to present two of her films and encountered the students of the Städelschule and our university, we talked, among many other things, about houses and living spaces. One of the continuities of both her life and work, Agnès said, are the houses where she lived. For practically as long as she has been active as a filmmaker and as a visual artist, Agnès Varda has lived in the same street and in the same house in Paris, on Rue Daguerre, which we will learn about tonight, in the 14th arrondissement in Paris, just off the Cimetière Montparnasse. In addition, she and Jacques Demy owned a house on the island of Noirmoutier, off the Atlantic coast near Nantes, where Demy was born and grew up, as everyone who's seen Jacques de Nantes will know. And both the house in the Rue Daguerre and the house on Noirmoutier and the island of Noirmoutier have been featured prominently in Varda's work. So both Rue Daguerre and Noirmoutier have been living spaces, but also sites of creation for Agnès Varda, locations and topics of her work. To explore the work of Agnès Varda, in other words, is also to explore the places and spaces that she inhabits as a creator and that she inhabits with and through her creations, both as a filmmaker and as a visual artist. Or to put it in other words, to speak about Varda the artist is also to speak about Paris, the city in which many of her films are set and which is the object of many of her works. Now, few people are better positioned to explore this particular facet of Varda's work than our guest tonight, Isabel McNeil. Isabel McNeil is a Philomathia Fellow in French at Trinity Hall and affiliated lecturer in the Department of French at the University of Cambridge. She's also the co-founder and organizer of the Cambridge Film Trust, that organization runs, among other things, the Cambridge Film Festival and a program of year-round events and other activities across the UK. So she's also a film culture activist, in addition to being a scholar, which makes her the perfect fit for this particular series, which we organize in a similar spirit. Isabel's research focuses on French cinema and on transnational cinema in the digital age. Her book, Memory and the Moving Image, French Film in the Digital Era, was published by Edinburgh University Press in 2012. That's a publisher with a particularly strong film list. Isabel's writings include essays on Jean-Luc Godard, Agnès Varda, and Yamina Benguigui, and her research addresses in particular issues related to cultural memory, urban space, and travel. The work Isabel presents tonight is part of a larger project on the representation of Paris in French cinema, or in cinema more generally speaking, particularly rooftops and attics, as I understand it. So it's a sort of a topography of cinematic spaces in the upper levels of the 19th century and 20th century Paris. Considering her long-standing engagement with and for the work of Agnès Varda and the high quality of her work on French cinema more generally, We are very proud that Isabel has agreed to participate in our lecture and film series. Please welcome together with me, Isabel McNeil.
Thank you for such a warm welcome. Thanks for having me here as part of this fantastic series. And a special thanks to everyone who's been involved in the organization of this event tonight. I wish I could have come to all the other screenings and events in the series. It's a brilliant idea and very exciting. I'm happy to be a part of it. So, first slide, I'm going to wave when I need a slide. Technical issues, but it won't be a problem. So Agnès Varda didn't set out to make a series of short films about Paris. So the Parisian shorts that I'm talking about tonight are a retrospective grouping. You might even call it a marketing strategy, because this is the grouping that Varda chose for the DVD collection of short films that she released, Tous Court, in 2007. And it was at this point that she grouped her short films into sections. Touristic shorts, ciné Varda photo, the essay, contestatory shorts, and of course the court parisien, the Parisian shorts. So I want to suggest that this acts as a kind of curation, and it encourages us as viewers to think about a diverse selection of films together. This raises the question, what happens when we watch them together as we do tonight? And just as importantly, it also highlights, obviously, Paris as a central theme running throughout these short films, even though many other themes are present. So it makes us think about the representation of Paris in relation to other spaces and ideas. And I'm grateful that Vincennes mentioned the idea of Noirmoutier, because the relation is often between Paris and the coast. In other words, Varda's curation of these short films as Paris films offers a lens through which to analyze them in relation to one another, as well as in relation to the city of Paris. And it also gives this particular group of films a place in Varda's oeuvre as a whole. It makes them connect to other Paris films like Cléo de Saint-Cassette and Daguerreotype. In this way, the Parisian shorts also ask to be understood in the context of Varda's own relation to Paris, as has been alluded to already, as she presents it in other films and paratextual materials. So in this presentation, I want to suggest that Varda's so-called Parisian shorts offer an illuminating vision of the city, producing cinematic ways of seeing that are personal, playful, and often quite humorous and funny, as we're going to see, but also critically engaged. That aspect of Varda cinema is always present. In the context of Paris, one of the most filmed and photographed cities of the world, Varda's films work against the construction of the city as a cinematic postcard, a concept that I'm going to expand upon. Without condemning tourism or postcards in themselves, especially not postcards, as we'll see, Varda shows us a critical alternative way of engaging with Paris, resisting the powerful cinematic imaginary of the city that tends to position its architecture and history as a consumable spectacle. So in the early 90s, Varda realized another curation, a curation of the self in book form called Varda par Agnès, a collage of images, ideas, and memories that form a sort of autobiography or art biography. And in this book, she recollects the making of Cléo de Saint-Cassette, and she describes how she felt about Paris as a provinciale, someone who didn't grow up there. What did Paris evoke for me? A diffuse fear of the big city and its dangers, of getting lost there alone, misunderstood, or being pushed around. These minimal fears very quickly became the fear of cancer, which in the 1960s had settled into everyone's minds. Of course, we can see how this informed the narrative of Cléo de Saint-Cassette. The protagonist of the film is herself a young provinciale who has a fearful relation to the city and is terrified of the cancer that she is going to discover inside her. But more importantly for the Parisian shorts, it reveals something about Varda's relation to Paris as an outsider, having grown up in Belgium and the south of France, who has herself experienced the feelings of fear and anxiety that can be provoked by the anonymity, the danger, and the strangeness of the capital. In her autobiographical film from 2008, Les Plages d'Agnès, Varda reenacts and reimagines her move from Set to Paris in a humorous manner, creating a montage that shows her in a barque latine, a typical local fishing boat, and then a few shots later, arriving in Paris in the same boat, as though she had continued sailing all the way to Paris. We used to say going up to Paris as though France were vertical, she tells us, turning to the camera from her boat, lightheartedly highlighting the hierarchical relation of Paris to the provinces. Yet in Les Plages too, Varda associates Paris with uneasiness. The gentle humour slips into something darker, visually as well as conceptually, as she passes in this boat underneath a bridge, recounting the gathering of her family during World War II. The war was still on, food rationing tickets, wooden shoe soles, and of course Paris was full of Germans, you know, the occupation. The streets were cold and dark, the street lights were out, in our houses we obscured the windows with blue paper. The boat passes quickly from under the bridge into the light again. And she moves from this dark atmosphere to talking about vitamin biscuits and learning about Mallarmé in air raid shelters. But still, it leaves us with this disquieting association with the city, and she also goes on to mention her homesickness for the seagulls and harbour of her former hometown. So later, her memories take on a gendered dimension, and this idea of gender in relation to the city is going to be something that features in several of the films we're going to see tonight. Again, speaking to the camera from her boat, she tells us that as a young woman in Paris, she didn't know many men, was nervous, introverted, apprehensive about everything around her. And she struggled with the problem of negotiating what she saw as a man's world. She found that as a teenager, men frightening and intimidating. But in speaking of these problems, she very quickly moves, jumps from one thing to another, you might say, as I'm coming back to her passion for surrealist poets. Nothing was better. It is clear that Paris was a space of artistic and intellectual discovery for Varda. And we hear about this in Les Plages d'Agnès, as well as in many of her other works, such as Agnès de Cy de la Varda, a series of television programs she made in 2011. Paris is shown to be a site of encounters with other artists who inspire her. So here. Here she is with Annette Messager and Christian Boltanski. Next one. Here she is with the street artist JR in the same courtyard of the Rue Daguerre that Vincennes mentioned. And she's currently working with JR on a crowdfunded film and street installation project. So, of course, this is the Rue Daguerre that was mentioned, the space where she's worked and lived for such a long time, with its resonant name exploited in the title of Daguerreotype. And this courtyard feels intimate and familiar to us. So often does it feature in Varda's films and the presented by Agnès mini-films that accompany each of her works on DVD. As she says, I live there, I work there, it's my default backdrop. So she's made many films outside of Paris, but it remains this central and focal point. But here we see, in this scene from Les Plages d'Agnès, this kind of staging that she likes to do in the city, making the city space into a beach, and you can really see that tension, I think, visualized here between her as someone who comes from the coast, who, if you opened me up, she says in Les Plages d'Agnès, you would find beaches, and yet someone whose central site of production and creativity is Paris. But what strikes me about all of these autobiographical encounters with the city are three key elements that are strongly relevant to the Parisian shorts. Firstly, this double outsider-insider status. Secondly, this fearfulness and strangeness associated with the French capital. And finally, the idea of Paris as a fertile site of creativity. For me, these aspects underpin Varda's taste for the unexpected perspectives on the city and the ambivalence associated with its multiplicity and possibilities, as well as her acute alertness to those who are made vulnerable in different ways within the urban environment. When taken together, these personal relations raise the question of perspective as central to any engagement with one's environment. Now, the mutual relation between person and place has been explored in various ways by scholars writing about Varda's work. For example, Delphine Benezet posits a phenomenological understanding of Varda's work, pointing out That for Varda, perhaps inspired by her classes with Gaston Bachelard, lived or inhabited space is known phenomenologically through participation or inhabitation of the world. And I think this is entirely apt for thinking about Varda's work. But in this presentation, I'm going to be particularly concerned with what this opens up for us as spectators and the critical or political possibilities that cinematographic ways of seeing might create. Now, I've mentioned this idea of ways of seeing a couple of times. I'm taking my cue here from the work of John Berger, the art historian, when he discusses artworks, both artworks themselves and the practice of art history in terms of ways of seeing. In other words, artworks embody certain ideas or ways of looking at the world in form and content, and the task of the art historian is to unfurl those ideas, whilst at the same time recognizing that one's own ways of seeing the world are also shaped by ideologies. So film, of course, is a medium par excellence for repeating and reinforcing ideology through the conventional assembling of images, or alternatively, for exposing it and offering new ways of seeing. And I should say that when I'm talking about seeing here, I'm talking about this broader sense of seeing or perceiving. For Varda, it is often as much about hearing as it is about looking with the eyes. But a further axis that I want to introduce to this for ways thinking about the ways in which cinematic forms might disrupt habitual ways of perceiving the world, is to turn to the political aesthetics of Jacques Rancière. For Rancière, aesthetic forms are always political because they reflect and shape what he calls the distribution of the sensible, determining what is seeable and sayable. He argues that emancipation begins when we dismiss the opposition between looking and acting and understand that the distribution of the visible itself is part of the configuration of domination and subjection, and that interpreting the world is already a means of transforming it or reconfiguring it. So in the case of Paris, Varda's filmmaking has to contend with a touristic imaginary of the city that also risks effacing from view the marginalized, the ugly, as well as the commodification that make Paris's worldwide image as beautiful possible. So this leads me to thinking about tourism and touristic cinema and anti-touristic cinema. Now, the affinities between tourism and cinema have not gone unnoticed, shall we say. For example, Eva Maziarska and John K. Walton point out that travel and cinema both derive from human curiosity, the need to learn about different places and people and respond to a desire to escape from mundane reality. But tourism gets a bad rep, precisely because it is often felt that being a tourist allows us to stay within our usual frames of reference. The tourist is often seen to be viewing a prepackaged and anticipated set of images on the tour. So Anne Friedberg refines these parallels, observing the peculiar similarity between tourist and cinema spectator. The subjective effects on the tourist are not unlike those of the cinema spectator. Tourism produces an escape from boundaries. It legitimates the transgression of one's static, stable, or fixed location. The tourist simultaneously embodies both a position of presence and absence, of here and elsewhere, of avowing one's curiosity and disavowing one's daily life. In other words, both tourism and cinema allow us to be in two places at once, offering a legitimate transgression of our usual spatial or temporal restrictions, whilst we really remain within a comfortable and familiar position. They're both also industries dependent on the circulation of signs and images as commodities. It's a nice postcard for you. So the postcard, with its capture and encapsulation of place for sale and distribution, can be seen as emblematic of the commodification and consumption of place that occurs in both tourism and cinema. Mariana Liz defines the term cinematic postcard to describe films that are particularly focused on touristic forms of representation. And in this, she talks about postcards or cinematic postcards being defined in part by content, such as monuments or a particular familiar atmosphere or character of a city, but also by a certain practice of tourism. So, consumed in a brief moment, postcards seem designed to do away with the time and the potentially the need for reflection, instead aiming for a widely accepted view of the place represented. Postcards, souvenirs, art, art postcards, and not least cinema itself, have developed a shorthand visual imaginary of the city of Paris, one that can be evoked in establishing shots that allow us, as spectators, to tour the city without really seeing it. Or rather, seeing exactly what we already expect to be there. Woody Allen's Midnight in Paris is a revealing example of the cinematic postcard and as a counterexample to Varda's work, particularly because it illustrates how the cultural past of the city, which is something I'm going to talk about a lot in relation to these short films, its artistic and literary history is often marshalled by cinema as part of a touristic itemization of the city. So when Gil, the film's protagonist, wanders around Paris and finds himself back in the Année Folle of the 1920s or even the Belle Époque of the 1890s, the spectator is given the pleasure of collecting already familiar reference points to Paris as a cultural space. So despite the period décor, when Gil encounters Hemingway or Dalí or Man Ray, the temporal and historical relations between past and present are absent. Gil is not really that bothered by his time travel. Instead, the past is offered as a collection of coexisting familiar signs, just as in a postcard, the city is a collection of familiar panoramas. So the problem with postcards then, and with such practices of cinematic tourism, is that they risk aggravating the blindness of familiarity, offering a widely accepted view that limits in advance our field of perception. Now, as you'll know if you've seen a lot of work by Agnès Varda, she loves postcards. She collects them, a habit inherited from her mother, as she tells us in Agnès de Sy de la Varda. This habit and predilection, of course, connected to her educational formation in art history, also to her work with still images as a photographer, but I think also to her identity as gleaner, as someone who collects and gathers what other people don't want, as explored in Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse and its sequel, Deux ans après, 2 years later. So Christa Blümlinger has examined the use of postcards in Varda's work. And she noted that Varda offers a way of using still images within the moving image that reconfigures postcard clichés, rendering the cliché dynamic through a reflection woven between text and image. Blümlinger concludes that Varda's installation piece, La Grande Carte Postale, from 2006, this was in her exhibition in Paris, L'Île et Elle, focusing on Noirmoutier and the coast, is paradigmatic of the way that Varda uses postcards. Now you have to imagine this is actually, the original was bigger than it is being shown here. This is a really vast postcard. Varda inserted windows, which you can see with the black squares, that could be opened by the exhibition visitor, each one containing a short film. And then every now and then this haunting, semi-transparent figure would appear over the top of the buxom beach blonde played by Varda's daughter Rosalie, and inspired by local 1950s postcards. So for Blümlinger, life and death, kitsch and art, photography and cinema, fixity and movement do not oppose each other in the figurative world of Agnès Varda, but are always thought in terms of their mutual relations. Now this got me thinking about Varda's cinema. Actually, this is what her cinema is all about. It can be seen as a cinema of relations. The image is always presented in a mapping or networked relation to other images or words. The postcard in Varda's work, therefore, is never only an image extracted from the world, framed, packaged, commodified, but always seen as part of a network of relations of images and ideas, including the networks of monetary transaction and exchange through which art circulates. So for example, in Le Lion Volatile, which we're going to see tonight, close-up shots emphasize the exchange of postcards for money, just as the clairvoyant is shown taking payment for her reading of the tarot cards. Images are not presented as straightforward in their visibility in Varda's works. Rather, like tarot cards, they are full of iconographic meanings and psychological resonance, as well as ultimately caught up in systems of exchange, which she often exposes and talks about quite directly. In my own work on cultural memory in cinema, I've explored the way in which Varda uses postcards among many other objects and images. As objects of cultural memory, where private worlds and a collective sphere intersect. Inspired by Gilles Deleuze, I've understood such cinematic remediation of objects in terms of the time image, where the virtual sphere of the past is activated and actualized through memory. So for example, in this sequence, Varda shows the different postcards that have been sent to her as a result of making her film about the Gleaners. So this is all these postcards of Millet's painting that people have sent to her. So each one of these postcards offers a kind of cliche of gleaning and of Millet's work, but when you bring them into contact with one another, into contact with her words on the soundtrack and her and the filming of her hands, she's inscribed into a set of relations of memory, the different associations we may have with it, those who owned the postcards and so forth. So it has a visual and conceptual layering in this scene, which proposes a meeting of actual and virtual, and where past and present come into contact in a dynamic relation. So the touristic cinematic postcard limits the field of vision by allowing the spectator to collect a series of widely accepted views, and Varda, on the other hand, reactivates that familiar by entering it into a network of relations in which the past, and as a virtuality, is in a dynamic loop with the present, and the individual memories, associations, and so forth intersect with a shared domain, a collective sphere. So this is a kind of theoretical understanding of the ways in which Varda's work offers alternatives to the touristic consumption of familiar images. I'm now going to look at the particular ways in which her Parisian shorts offer new ways of seeing the city of Paris. Broadly speaking, starting off by thinking about the representation of the body in relation to the city, moving on to looking at the surrealist shock, and before finally returning to these questions of cultural memory and the role of art and cinema in seeing the city. So many critics have noted the way that people and place cannot be understood in isolation from one another in Varda's work. We have an example from Sandy Flitterman Lewis. For many of her films, Varda starts with a locale, and it's the interaction of the character and the milieu that produces the theme or meaning of the film. This is certainly apt for both L'Opéra Mouffe from 1958 and Elsa La Rose, 1965. These are quite different films, but both offer very generative ways of seeing and hearing the connections between people and place. Yet, along with L'Édite Cariatide, these films also show that the relation between bodies and urban space is a question of time, of the way entrenched distributions of visibility have accumulated across time through history to order our sense perceptions. So L'Opéra Mouffe, to start with this one, was made while Varda was pregnant with Rosalie and explicitly situates itself as being made from the perspective of a pregnant woman. It offers a mixture of exterior sequences filmed in the Cinquième, in the Fifth District, in the Mouffe area around the Rue de Mouffetard, whose central axis is a market lining the Rue Mouffetard. So street shot images of market produce, people talking, drinking and walking are interspersed with interior and courtyard scenes of a young couple, as well as evocative images designed to convey the anxieties and fantasies of pregnancy. Presenting the film, Varda describes the uneasy tension between the joy and hopefulness of the pregnant woman and the abject poverty of what was then, as is evident in the film, a desperately poor and run-down area of Paris. And it's interesting to think about the Rue Mouffetard now as a completely touristic area full of restaurants and things like that. A central power of the film is simply to make us look at what we tend to turn away from or fail to see. The camera homes in on toothless mouths, ancient wrinkled skin, vacant drunken gazes, limping gaits, missing limbs, snotty noses, and generally on the cold, the aged, the poor, the undervalued, and the marginalized. Through the interaction with the rhythms on the musical soundtrack, and it is an opera, it's sung, each becomes in his or her own way an aesthetic object worthy of cinematic attention. Equally, however, Varda draws our gaze to the beautiful young couple, and we intrude upon their intimacy, their embraces and nakedness. We have extreme close-ups that take us very close to the body in this film, to the stretched belly button of a pregnant woman, or to the goosebumps on the flesh of the couple, of the lovers. But the first chord of La Mouffe, so the song tells us, is food, la bouffe. And we're also made to gaze rather uneasily at a world of consumption that seems to expose an uncanny loss of boundaries between the human and the non-human. So vegetables become strangely anthropomorphic, such as the pumpkin hacked open that resonates with the rounded form of the pregnant belly seen in the previous shot, or leeks, whose roots suddenly seem peculiarly hairy. In the section entitled Cravings, a montage of edible eyes, hearts, tongues, and intestines plays with the unstable border between disgust and hunger, the disturbance that one might associate with pregnancy of the usual thresholds of desire and nausea is thus extended to urban space. So I'm thinking about also the filming of the poor. The city's usual regimes of visibility, which determine what is desirable and what is abject, are troubled and destabilized by the film. Elsa La Rose, which is made in 1965 and was released in 1966, is in some ways a very different sort of film. Rather than focusing on these unknown somebodies who are not usually in our field of vision, it takes as its subject matter a hugely well-known Parisian couple, the surrealist poet Louis Aragon and his lifelong partner, muse and fellow writer Elsa Triolet. Varda is therefore contending not so much with the unseen, but rather with two familiar signs, at least to a French audience of the time. In Varda par Agnès, she describes her desire to avoid depicting them as what she calls this kind of monument with two heads that they had already become. Now that made me think of what Robert Musil says about monuments, how they tend to go unnoticed and unseen. Why? I missed one. There is nothing in the world as invisible as monuments. There is no doubt that they are erected in order to be seen, indeed to arouse attention, but at the same time, they are somehow impregnated against attention. It runs down them like water on oilcloth without stopping for an instant. So as a two-headed monument associated with the legendary literary and creative scene of Montparnasse in the Paris of the 20s and 30s, Elsa and Aragon had somehow to be renewed in collective visibility. The Parisian scene of their infamous first meeting at La Coupole and the touristic fantasy that accompanies that of the Montparnasse cafe scene, with its other iconic locations such as Le Dôme, La Rotonde, Le Select, had to be evoked without functioning as a cinematic postcard. And this is partly achieved in the film by defamiliarizing Aragon's poetry and therefore his poetic encapsulation of Elsa herself. So Varda was completely dismayed by the way that Aragon intoned his own poetry, which he found kind of pompous and theatrical. And so instead she asked the actor Michel Piccoli to read the poems for the soundtrack in a strange rhythm of extreme acceleration and sudden pause, comme une messe bâclée, as Varda puts it, like a priest rushing too quickly through his Latin mass. And this then contrasts with and destabilizes a very romantic rendition of Aragon's Que serais-je sans toi, as sung by Jean Ferrat in a popular recording of 1964 that also features on the soundtrack. As for the spaces of Montparnasse themselves, they are presented, of course, as traversed by multiple relations between past and present, here and elsewhere, and as such they are rendered both familiar and strange. When we see images of the cafes, such as in this slide, the commentary displaces the centrality of their famous names, focusing instead on an oblique view of Elsa's personal story. Many scenes in the film are also shot outside Paris, in the couple's home at the time of shooting in Saint-Arnoult-en-Yvelines, and this creates a connection between the mythical Paris of their youth and their present-day environment, a rural space which is also where the film ends geographically. And a lovely pastoral sequence, which recalls Jean Renoir's 1936 film Partie de Campagne, which was also shot in the Seine-et-Oise, particularly as this was an excursion of Parisians to the countryside in Renoir's film, which is kind of what we do in the course of Elsa La Rose. So the Paris of Elsa La Rose also enters into a relation with Russia, the Russia of her past, and Berlin, where she and Aragon lived at the same time without meeting one another. Scenes of the couple strolling down the streets of Montparnasse offer a vision of the aging couple reinserted into the sights of their youth. Even more striking is the stage reenactment, one of Varda's favorite procedures, of Elsa and Aragon's legendary first meeting in La Coupole. So here Varda brings an image of the present day Elsa visually into the scene of Aragon's and our collective memory, using three shots of the same moment of her entering the bar through swing doors, with a faint echo here of the three much more quickly repeated shots of Cleo descending the staircase when she leaves the tarot card reader in Cleo de Saint-Cassette. In Elsa, this repetition of this moment of her walking through the door also highlights, this also highlights the artifice of restaging the past, particularly as the production notes for the film make clear that this was shot, strangely, not in La Coupole itself, where the original event took place, but close by, in the Dôme, another legendary café from the 20s, and also a crucial location in Cléo de Saint-Cassette. This almost repeating image of Elsa emerging through the doors is marked by a curious mixture of diegetic sound. You have the clinking of café cups, the clanking of the door, along with an extra diegetic harp glissando. So it makes this very sort of strange combined effect that at once seems mythical with this harp and at the same time absolutely banal, something that just happened in a café. Here, as throughout the film, Varda manages to make us see not the past in itself as it was, but the myth of the past in its encounter with present-day reality. And this is not just a poetic approach, but also political. For this focus on the present day emphasizes the way that Elsa is, of course, the beautiful muse, the poem, the writer, and also an aging woman, in whom Varda still finds a cinematic fascination, much as she will with her own hands and aging hands and hair in Les Glaneurs, for example, many years later. In that sense, the film is as much about seeing the rose in Elsa's present day, time-worn face and body, as it is about offering a reviewing of the time-worn myths of Les Années Folles in Montparnasse and of the couple as one of its two-headed monuments. So Elsa La Rose is therefore one of a number of films in which Varda considers the question of the place of feminine beauty in the city, in culture and in history. Les Dites Caryatides and its sequel, Les Dites Caryatides bis, which by the way I added into this, into Varda's curation because it fits so perfectly, continue this reflection in a very explicit relation to the architectural and poetic history of Paris. So Les Dites Caryatides from 1984 is also at pains to counteract the invisibility of monuments. The caryatids, or pillars in female form, that adorn many Parisian buildings aren't really monuments as such, but they do commemorate something, even though they don't intend to, because they embody what Varda calls une certaine idée de la femme en architecture, a certain idea of woman in architecture. The first premise of Varda's film is that we no longer notice these naked women exposed to the gaze in the streets. Her film encourages us to look up, to see them, to appreciate, even to admire them. But it also reveals, critically, the ways of seeing that the caryatids embody in their architectural form. For the first aim of making the caryatids visible again, Varda uses an incredible range of techniques for such a short film. One of them is to repeatedly deploy an upwards moving vertical tracking shot, which has a double aim. On the one hand, it encourages us to look up above eye level, and secondly, it enables to see the caryatids close up in ways not usually accessible to human eyes, unless maybe we're a window cleaner or something. Sometimes she uses a tilt of the camera upwards, echoing the raising of the human gaze as if to remind us of that possibility, which we all know we often forget as we walk around cities. More playfully and unexpectedly, Varda uses staged set pieces to make us rethink the relation of bodies and the gaze in the city. And I guess it's a kind of visual spoiler of sorts to show you this image of a naked male body walking through the streets of Paris. It emerges somewhat unexpectedly at the start of the film. So the film begins with images, the camera grazing up the bronze form of female statues, but this is quickly contrasted with this image of a living naked man. And on the commentary, Varda tells us, "The nude in the street is more often in bronze than in flesh, more often in stone than in human skin." Here, as throughout the film, Varda will be concerned with the relations between living, breathing flesh and the construction materials of stone or metal. Curiously, by focusing on inanimate, constructed bodies, Varda asks us to think about real bodies, particularly female ones, and the ways in which they are put to work as hidden labour, often commodified or objectified, or marshalled as discourse. So unlike the straining muscular atlases, the female caryatids do not appear to be working to hold up the buildings. Moreover, Varda reminds us of the origins of the caryatids, situating them in architectural history. The origins were the women of Caryae, condemned to slavery and made to parade through the streets as punishment for betraying Athens in the Greco-Persian Wars. She uses the word kolebo when recounting this story, subtly drawing a link between the women of Caryae and the public shaming of women collaborators during the Épuration after the Second World War, when women were also paraded through the streets as part of the punishment. Varda thus very lightly reminds us that the female body is politically charged, made to serve not only architecture, but also the processing of collective guilt and the memory of conflict. When we watch the very short later film, Les Petites Caryatides Bis, which is basically just, it's almost a slideshow of further caryatids that Varda found after she made the first film, one image in particular stands out. Here on the corner of the Rue Réaumur and the Rue Saint-Denis, the past and present of the commodification of the female form jostle side by side. So I've spoken of Varda's cinema working through relations, through juxtaposition and association, in a word, montage. This is connected for me in part with Varda's long-time fascination with surrealism, which manifests itself in her work quite often as a playful humour. But on a more profound level, the legacy of surrealism in Varda's work takes the form of a very particular and critical use of incongruity, the juxtaposition of that which does not seem logically or rationally connected. A short interview film by Alain Bergala and Anne Huet from 2007 is entitled Du coq à l'âne, a French idiom that literally means from the cockerel to the donkey and that roughly translates as jumping from one thing to another. And it becomes apparent in the film that this title comes from Varda's own awareness of her tendency to jump from one thing to another in conversation. This process of unexpected associations, either between shots or within a shot, or between soundtrack and image, is reminiscent of the associational psychic automatism championed by the surrealists, loosely based on a Freudian conception of free association. So when André Breton defined surrealism in the first Surrealist Manifesto in 1924, the freedom to which they aspired, that is freedom from the strictures of supposedly rational thought, constrained by repetitious and moribund social structures, was dependent on, as you can see here, certain forms of association. Now, in interview, Varda gives a very clear and revealing picture of the intertwining of conscious, rational attention and something like automatism in her process of creation. She describes the pre-production and shooting phase of making a film in terms of moments of extreme and incessant organization at the same time as being in a semi-conscious state. But this is always preceded by a certain consciousness, attentive consciousness of the project, and it's followed by a synthetic approach in editing, which nonetheless incorporates some of this non-rational and uncontrolled. Varda has often said that surrealist art and writing were formative artistic interests for her. When she was 15 or 16, she tells us, nothing was more fascinating than René Magritte and André Breton, as well as Louis Buñuel's L'Âge d'Or. Breton's books Nadia and L'Amour Fou from 1928 and 38 seem particularly relevant to Varda's portrayals of Paris as a catalyzing space of possible connections between people and things, as seen in L'Opéra Mouffe. Both Nadia and L'Amour Fou depict Paris as containing the unnerving potential to disrupt one's obvious pathways, sight lines, and perspectives, triggering those certain forms of association that Proton refers to in the manifesto. And I think we can also see here how this resonates with Varda's outside of view of Paris as an uneasy and uncertain space. This is the sort of positive side of that. Le Lion Volatile offers a striking example of the way a surrealist approach to the city can disrupt its touristic vistas at the same time as making us perceive its monuments through new eyes. The film presents a cinematic realization of Breton's surrealist suggestion that the Lion de Belfort, a monumental leonine statue that dominates the Place d'Enfer Rochereau, should be given a bone to chew on. Oh, I'm behind one. The Lion de Belfort is a bronze reproduction of a colossal stone sculpture in Belfort, and it was created to commemorate the heroism of the French during the siege of Belfort in 1870-71 in the Franco-Prussian War. And this was a struggle that was led by the Colonel d'Enfer Rochereau, whose name is given to the square, and whose nickname was the Lion of Belfort, so that's the connection there. But this is fascinating because although it explicitly celebrates French heroism, the sculpture was created at a time of terrible French defeat, when French morale was low. So it's a symbolic disavowal of military failure, which mirrors, very interestingly, the 1879 renaming of the square, which used to be called La Place d'Enfer, or Hell Square, to La Place d'Enfer Rochereau. So, in other words, the lion's courage obscures, in more than one sense, a hidden hell. So in Le Lion Volatile, Varda inscribes herself as both an inhabitant of the 14th district, the area of the Rue Daguerre, after all, and at the same time into a tradition of revolt against the ideas overtly embodied by the lion as monument. And she depicts herself sitting on a bench in the film, presumably reading the sixth edition of the review Surrealism in the Service of Revolution, which included in 1933 proposals for the irrational embellishment of a city. Shortly afterwards, through the point of view of the character Clarisse, Breton's literary irreverence towards the establishment, as incarnated by the Lion, is visualized through the photographic effect of superimposition. But in Le Lion Volatile, Varda is not attacking the monument as the surrealists did. It's not quite the same. In giving the lion a bone, Varda chooses probably the least aggressive of the suggestions that were made by the surrealists. So for example, Tristan Zara proposed that the lion should be pierced with a spit and roasted in bronze flames. So Varda's version of contestation does not involve fighting fire with bronze fire, but instead taming and reappropriating the lion for the pleasure of the inhabitants of the local area. She tells us in a little prologue that just as Gugu, her cat, is the mascot of Cine Tamaris, we're going to see him quite a lot, I think, so the Lion de Belfort is the mascot of the 14th district. The lion is reclaimed from its official purposes and domesticated into a lucky and friendly presence. The postcards that Varda shows in the prologue situate this reclaiming in a history of local traditions in which the lion has been the backdrops for carnivals and fun fairs and has even been plastered with election posters. It's a space, she doesn't refer to this, but it's also a place that's well known for being the beginning of demonstration marches, often the beginning and end of demonstrations in Paris. In the film's narrative, the lion is a mutable yet benevolent presence. So although one of the characters is seen weeping when the fortune teller tells her that she's going to have to get used to this being on her own and living with a cat, for Clarisse, when her boyfriend Lazare disappears, she is happy to see a giant purring cat. Zgugu, of course, has taken the place of the lion on its plinth. So to conclude then, as I've suggested, in thinking about the ways in which Varda's cinema works against the touristic practice of the cinematic postcard, the cinematic objects that she gleans and juxtaposes are not only surrealist trouvailles or found objects. Like the Caryatids or the Lion de Belfort, Varda's images are also frequently objects of cultural memory. As I've argued, by mobilizing objects and images on film, Varda encourages us to perceive their temporal density, We hear and see not just the image on screen, but also the virtual realm of the past, which the object in all its relations activates. And just a further example of this from L'Edit Cariatide, there's a well-known aria from Offenbach's La Belle Hélène, which is sung on the soundtrack by the male singer and composer François Wertheimer. So the bored Helen, nurturing an adulterous passion for Paris, here the hero from Greek myth rather than the city, is transformed into a desiring male voice, lusting after the voluptuous stone bodies of the naked Cariatids on the image track. Now, if we happen to recall the Offenbach aria, associations form. This humorous reappropriation of the popular 19th century opéra bouffe serves to highlight, playfully, the forgotten purpose of the Cariatids as objects of the desiring male gaze, whilst also reinforcing the context of the Second Empire, Paris, the city this time. Cultural allusions, particularly when incongruously juxtaposed, activate our own memories, personal and shared, in order to release the latent history hidden, held within objects and places. So the Paris these short films present to us is rich with visual and oral allusion. In L'Opéra Mouffe, among the flow of images of lovers caressing and gazing at one another, is a moment that triggers a memory of another image, another woman's body. The curves of the bedstead and the shadows they cast on Dorothée Blanc's naked back immediately recall Man Ray's famous Violon d'Ingres, which in turn evokes the painting by Ingres that inspired it. When Dorothée is seen alone, still naked, but reclining, her pose and the mirror evoke Velázquez's Venus at Hermira. And now that we see this in the present day, Dorothée's sensuous curves may even evoke for us her later crucial role in Cléo de Saint-Cassette as an artist's model, offering an alternative perspective on the female body as object of the gaze. Now, as a critic, one can analyse all of these connections and the meanings that they release, as I have done several times in this talk and in my writing on Varda. But right now I want to highlight the dream space that Varda creates through her multiple forms of association, in which our personal memories and a broader cultural sphere intersect. All this depends on chance, of course, the chance of recognition in the moving flow of images, le beau hasard que devient le souvenir, the beautiful chance that memory becomes, as Godard says in his video essay, Histoire du cinéma. And here is Godard himself, who we might recognize from behind his infamous dark glasses, playing opposite Anna Karina, his lover and wife-to-be at the time. His fat tears, visible tears, and tilted head recall another famous Man Ray photograph, while the doll-like women in Les Fiancées du Pont MacDonald bat their eyelashes, a movement that's reinforced with percussion on the soundtrack, drawing attention to exaggerated false eyelashes as if to complete the allusion to Les Larmes. Although Varda has always distanced herself from the cinephilia of her fellow New Wave filmmakers such as Godard and Truffaut, her allusions are often cinematic, if not cinephile. The whole of Les Fiancées du Pont MacDonald is a parody of silent cinema, as well perhaps of a broader tradition of classical cinema with its vision of the world in terms of black or white. Godard himself seems to have become a young Buster Keaton. A sad clown in a straw boater hat. And there are lots of other references and allusions that you'll notice in the film. The tiny film about the Cinémathèque Française, T'as de beaux escaliers, tu sais, you've got beautiful stairs, centres on the idea of cinema as a focal point of cultural memory as well as a feature of Parisian topography. The title is a surrealist joke on one of the most famous lines ever uttered in French cinematic history, Jean Gabin in the Quai des Brumes telling Michel Morgan that she has beautiful eyes. T'as de beaux yeux, tu sais. The film asks us to look again at the Cinémathèque and remember its crucial role in the history of French cinema. But through its montage of clips from iconic films, it also triggers our own personal associations and memories. And these are then linked through more or less subtle graphic matches to the steps of the Cinémathèque, underscoring relations between cinema, memory, and the urban landscape. Now, this harks back, of course, to the association for Varda between Paris and creativity, but here the cliché of familiar images appear as anything but a widely accepted view. So to sum up, in this presentation, I've tried to show the diverse ways in which Varda uses sets of relations to disrupt familiar or preconceived ways of seeing the city. Through allusions and associations, and here are some more of my own, the hidden margins or histories of the city become visible in these shorts. The films invite us to revel in Paris as a space of creativity, of cinema, and of a rich cultural past, seeing its monuments with new eyes. In so doing, Varda often redistributes the sensible, to use Rancière's terms, and resists dominant ideologies. It is the case in different ways in all of the longer films in the group. But she also curates images of Paris and in relation to Paris that activate the spectator's own memories of art and urban space. So before we turn to the projection, I leave you with this final image. This is the former site of the clairvoyant caravan that we see in Le Lion Volatile, which burnt down for unknown reasons in 2013. For me, it's a vivid emblem, I think, of how Varda's Parisian shorts open our eyes to the mysteries of Paris, as to the mutability and precariousness of its landmarks and people. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Isabelle, for this great lecture.
It's something that Varda has spoken about, not in relation to these shorts as a program, but in terms of something that fascinates her, that's kind of a driving force behind a lot of her cinema. She says it's the lien, it's the connection between people, and then it's actually in the interview Ducoq Alan that she talks about this, and she says, yes, it's between people, and that's also between the audience and the film. And I think she's interested in how that in all the different kinds of creativity and creation that arise from the between of two people, and yes, that often is a heterosexual couple in her films and in these films. But that betweenness is something that she then, when she's talking about it, she then immediately links that to the installation, The Widows of Noirmoutier, and to this was an installation where you could sit in the audience and watch different films with different headsets that link to different films. So that becomes the link. So she makes this explicit connection between the link between and in between couples and the link between film and audience, which I think is interesting. It's something to do with that, those generative possibilities of what happens when you bring things together, people together, images together, or indeed audience and film together.
Since you brought up Les Veuves de Noirmoutier, which is a work that she also talked about when she was here 2 weeks ago, it's actually a sort of a series of portraits or interviews of widows. And one of the reasons why that she gave why she made the film is that, in a way, she herself is a Veuve de Noirmoutier. But it was also, her idea was to, offer a series of portraits and talk to people and let people talk who usually nobody talks to and who nobody ever listens to. She spoke about one of the daughters of the widows who came up to her after having seen the work and saying, "You made me listen to my mother." She was someone who she hadn't listened to in a long time. And I think one of the other things other traits that we can discover in all the films that you showed us is that she has a way of looking at people that no one else looks at, and of discovering people in the urban space that would normally not go noticed. And I found it very interesting what you told us about her own experience of arriving in Paris and discovering the city as sort of this fascinating space of creation, but also a male-dominated space and a space where, certain people roam around freely, and she somehow had to negotiate her place. And so that particular sensibility and that particular, attention to the people no one else looks at, particularly old women, for instance, I find striking as well.
Yeah, I think the theme of the older female face and body is something that has been obviously you can see in L'Opéra Mouffe. It's this incredible thread running through Varda's work, And which is only now being met by people like Carlos Regadas and, you know, other film who she speaks to in Agnès de Sidela Varda. But she's in another of her short films, the essay film Cette pièce cuisine et salle de bain. She also has a naked old woman sort of sitting surrounded by feathers. And in Réponse de femme, her kind of militant feminist film, she explicitly addresses this idea that women are not allowed to grow old. And that was obviously something that fascinated her in making Elsa, because she actually talks about the way that within the film you have Elsa saying, "Oh, I feel like I let the readers down because I've aged, and I don't age in poetry, but in the flesh I do." But when Varda's talking about that film, she also mentions that Aragon himself would repeat this kind of received idea that, you know, isn't it tragic the way Elsa's, the way women age so badly, and, you know, the way Elsa has aged. So he kind of feeds into this idea. I think she makes us look at sort of things that we don't ordinarily see in that way, or that we don't ordinarily see as beautiful, and somehow manages actually to go beyond that dichotomy of beauty and ugliness, which I think is really, really important for the political aspect of these films. I mean, I know sort of these are very funny films. I was really enjoying the humor of them as I was watching them again just now. But I hope that in my talk, and that when you were watching them, you could see that there's always this kind of critical angle. Even in the Lion Volatile, you know, she's never lets things be completely anodyne and humorous. There's always this kind of political or critical engagement, I think, that's there.
Yeah, I mean, the key idea of your talk was the idea of the cinematic postcard and the deconstruction of the cinematic postcard in Varda's Paris films. And I think that it's a beautiful idea that I really like, and that you presented to us. And I think it expands beyond just architecture and the history of the city, but also to social relations and to the people in the city. I'm sure we have lots of questions from the audience. Sie können wie immer die Fragen in der Sprache Ihrer Wahl stellen, und wir versuchen es dann zu übersetzen.
And just give me a sign and I come to you with the mic.
Yeah, Mark,
on the other side of the room.
That's athletic.
Thanks.
Okay, I have two questions. I'll try to be to express them succinctly. The first, maybe just picking up on the discussion, I'm often torn, to be quite honest, as to what exactly the politics are that we're talking about. And specifically when one talks gender politics, to try to understand that better, because if we, you know, recall from last week, we saw Le Bonheur, and in a certain sense, what we see in the Godard short is also, you know, whatever, one woman dies, a woman in blackface, maybe, thank goodness, but no, one woman dies.
I don't think she's in blackface.
Is she? Okay, I didn't know, whatever.
Yeah.
A woman dies.
It's an interesting point.
Yeah, that could be. That's another subject. Yeah. But a woman dies, and then she could be replaced by another. Like the replaceability of the woman, the exchangeability of the woman, from the male perspective, as long as he's happy. I'm just sort of giving a polemic reading of that, and then trying to understand the what's going on in Le Lion Volatile with the kind of replacement of the lion with the cat. The cat, we were told, is serenity. You know, is like, is that a good thing? Women, like, don't be dependent on a man? Or is it, relax, you're never going to get a man, so you're going to be sad, they're going to leave you. Anyway, throw that out there. The second question has to do with the question of curating. Because I think, I also thought that was very interesting that you, in a sense, reversed what often happens with the digital, is you actually took the digital curation, if you will, as a model for analog programming. They're curating, and I wonder, I wonder if you have some reflections on the differences there, because you added another film, so you violated the principle, if you will, but Varda, like what curating for the digital, you know, a DVD differences there with the film program?
Thank you for a really interesting question. So with the first one, I would say, I think it's, I could see lots of people nodding in the room when you're saying about being perplexed about the politics. And I think that absolutely, that idea of being perplexed by the politics is exactly right, because these are not films that necessarily have a political message, I would say. This is more about making us think. And that's what I feel with Varda, is that it's always one thing and another. Just when you think, you know, you've kind of got what she's getting at, then there's something comes along that undermines it. In Le Lion Volatile, I think it's really open. You don't really know. I mean, I don't think we're meant to sort of decide whether we think that, you know, it's a good thing that, you know, there's the song on the soundtrack, Where Do Men Go When They Disappear? You know, is this really all about, you know, men are bust as they abandon us or something? No, because he's a magician. Does he really exist anyway? I mean, there's this whole thing about he's called Lazare Combe, and then you see the word Combe from Catacombe, like life size, written right next to him. He's a cinematic creation. I think we can't, you know, she undermines she really emphasizes the artifice of cinema in this film. And with the prologue as well, I think she undermines the idea that we can read it in a straightforward narrative sense that would give us that kind of message. Instead, she makes us think, you know, how do we use signs to understand the world? How do we go to tarot? Okay, so we go and get our cards read so that we can understand something about ourselves. Or, you know, we look around us at the other people and see what they're doing. We look around in public squares and see how lovers are and what they're supposed to be. You know, I think that's, for me, that's the political, if you like, is in the aesthetic, is in the game that she plays in these films. Les Fiancés du Pont MacDonald is definitely less political. I think the whole idea of sort of black and white becomes more troubling when you see it reinserted back into Cléo. When you see it in Cléo, I find it much more like, you know, when I watch it in this series of films, I don't see it as blackface. I see it as like a negative, like a photographic negative or a positive. You know, it's that kind of black and white. When you see it watching Cléo, it's a shorter version, I should say, when it's shown in as part of Cléo. It's not exactly the same film, but it's based on this. Then with the whole kind of discourse around masks and the African masks and the black man that Cléo finds frightening, I see the black and white thing becoming much more complex. But I mean, she definitely made it as a, you know, let's make a funny film with my friends. I definitely see that as less politically charged as a film. In terms of the digital and the analog, I think it's. I think we're just living in a world where we can't take the cinematic projection, the analog projection of films as the starting point necessarily, especially when some of these films were made for television, or Le Lion Volatile was kind of made for a compilation film that she got either kicked out of or never happened. It's unclear whether it then went on to become Paris Je T'aime. I don't know. It was a film in which different filmmakers were filming different districts of Paris. So all of these films kind of have different relations to the project, cinematic projection model. And maybe that's part of being short films as well. You know, short films, they don't kind of have that usual distribution and exhibition circuit and position. So yeah, I think it kind of makes sense with these films to start with the digital, and then I don't know. Watching it tonight, was it the right decision to include Lady Caryatide Bis? I don't know. It just feels like it felt like it was going to have a natural home there, and I wasn't sure in the end if that was true or not. But I think it's always a different mode of attention when you see something in the cinema. And most of these I hadn't seen in the cinema before, and I just thought it was amazing to explore the image in that way, with that mode of attention, that extreme of attention that you get in the cinema. It seemed like a great enhancement of the digital curation. But
yeah. Irina.
We show Paris Je T'aime next month, by the way.
It's a little plug.
I was wondering whether there was a difference in dealing with monuments in space. If you compare the films, or look at the films as documentaries on the one hand, and fiction films on the other. I had the feeling that in the Cléo Cinquassette short and in Le Lion Volatile, it was much more, let's say, three-dimensional. I thought the documentaries were much more, maybe because they were also dealing a lot with cutouts, they were much more flat in the composition than the fictional films, who kind of used the space and all the, I mean, the Cléo film with the bridges, how they kind of used the space for the narration, for the story. But I don't know, do you have an idea about that?
I think that's an amazing observation. I'm not sure if I can respond to it. It does just, it's a bit tangential, but it does remind me that the running up and down of the stairs that you get on the bridges in the Fiancée du Pont McDonald is comes into the publicity film that she made for the Cinémathèque through the music. So it's kind of, although she modestly doesn't show her own film, the stairs of her own film, she kind of keeps it through Michel Legrand's improvised score. So there's a nice connection there. But yeah, I think I hadn't really thought about it, but I think you're right. There's this movement through space that you get with them crossing the square in the Lion Volatile, running up and down bridges. In L'Opéra Mouffe, yeah, it's that kind of focused capturing, almost still portrait that she gives us with the movement in the image. I think that's interesting. Again, this is a bit tangential, but there's also a long portrait of Aragon looking in the mirror, which is again very flat. You think it's a photograph for a while, and then he begins to move, and you realize that it's actually 1965, anticipating daguerreotype, and probably what Kate Ince is going to talk about in May when she talks about Paris portraits. So yeah, I think that's a great juxtaposition to explore further, but I probably need to think a bit about it.
Kalani.
Yeah, I was also interested in the photographs, but of Elsa. And I was thinking about what you said with respect to the tarot cards and the postcards, which I found really interesting, because it not only calls attention to the way in which these need to be interpreted, and once they're interpreted, different constellations come to the fore that you didn't see before, but also the way in which it undoes a kind of indexicality of the city, that it calls attention to this artifice that's on the surface. And I was thinking about that with the way she uses the pictures of Elsa, the same picture over and over again, and talk about different parts of her life. And I really liked that move, because it seemed to be less about fixing the past or understanding photographs as something of the past, but rather to understand them as an invitation for posterity to interpret in the future. And I was wondering if you had any further information about how those photographs were used or what the concept was behind that.
Yeah, as far as I know, I don't think Varda talks, she talks about the photographs in Elsa in particular, but yeah, I think it's really striking the way she uses photographs, as you say, very much in the present, so displayed in the home, and kind of shows them in relation to Aragon moving around and Aragon looking at himself in the mirror. So he's talking about how he's got to imagine Elsa. And then what he does is he doesn't look at the photographs, which are all displayed around him, but he looks at himself. So yeah, I think, but we obviously keep on seeing, as the camera moves around their home, we keep on seeing these photographs, we keep on returning to them. She also uses photographs, perhaps in a related way, although in a very different context, in L'Opéra Mouffe, when she shows the photographs of the homeless people who died while she was making the film, become icons. She kind of inserts them into that image of religious icons. So yeah, she definitely uses the still image as a, and maybe this relates to this question about the documentaries kind of using the flat image, the less dimensionality of moving through space. She kind of inserts still images into the flow of the moving image in ways that suddenly make us think about things in a different way, and you know, realize the constructedness or the other interpretations that we need to have in order to kind of, yeah, bring out all the different possibilities of those images. So yeah, I think that's a really lovely point. I mean, interesting about the indexicality, there is a kind of power of the index in Varda's filmmaking as well. You know, you see these people that were there, kind of caught, captured on film. But that I think she is never just the cinematic eye, you know, perceiving the world. It's always kind of reused and reconfigured so that even with the music sometimes it's a way of doing that. But, yeah.
I'm still wondering about the point you made about the political implications in these films. I don't know whether I can articulate already what I have in mind, but I'll try. Let's take the last one, Le Lion Volatile. I've got the suspicion that the politics implied just mean rendering things harmless in a way. The Lion is a good case in point. It's a strong, mighty animal. Providing it with a bone already makes it, ridicules it somehow. And putting a cat, an ordinary cat, lion is a cat, of course, also, in its place is rendering him completely harmless. Are these the politics of this film?
Yeah, well, I thank you. That's really helpful. I did think about that, especially thinking about the kind of aggressive politics that the surrealists had in relation to the same statue. And I suppose I've tried to argue that the rendering harmless is sort of rendering harmless these militaristic discourses of the state. I mean, we always see the plinth à la défense nationale, you know, to national defense. It kind of reminds us that this is about a militaristic using of monuments to impose a kind of state discourse on public space. And so the rendering, I was arguing that, can we see this rendering harmless, this taming of the lion, rather than seeing it as just, neutralizing any sort of danger and threat in it per se, that actually it's about saying, actually, we reclaim this from the state. We make it into our pet, we make it into our neighborhood pet. And we do what we, you know, and this is about a quartier, a space in Paris where we're going to live regardless of whatever the way the state wants to organize historical narratives about that space. So yeah, bringing back the barrière d'enfer as well, kind of really highlighting that aspect of the history of the place. So I don't know, I mean, I think that comes perhaps more from seeing the film in conjunction with the other films and with Varda's other work. If we just watch it in isolation, maybe that we just think, oh, this is just, you know, a silly game and it's funny and cute. But I think that really is what she does with monuments generally. So I think I still see that working in this film too.
I think the Musil quote that you projected and used in your talk is highly pertinent to both this film and L'Edit Cariatide, because even she didn't notice all the ones that are there.
Yeah.
They're made to be seen, but they're at the same time they're invisible. And in a way, what she does with the Le Lion Volatile is to make the monument visible, literally.
And visible in its temporal density. So right. it's she explicitly mentions its past. I mean, she keeps it pretty light. She doesn't go into much detail about its history, but she just reminds us that that's what it was, you know, that's where it's come from. And then all of our stories in the city, our meetings, our encounters, the things that we're looking for and trying to understand, those take place, you know, we're constantly interacting with these messages that we're not necessarily reading, but they're there. And that's very interesting in Paris, because there's so much that is caught up with the history of colonialism, for example, which comes into Cléo de Saint-Cassert in very interesting ways.
Sorry, I have the microphone again. I just because I kind of question the politics, which I still think is worth discussing, I just wanted to say also that I think there is a kind of, if you will, classic and important feminist politics of marking the position of women or the distribution of roles according to gender. Even, I mean, I don't know if I've ever seen a film before where it is identified as being shot by a pregnant woman. I mean, that's quite an incredible public act of self-naming and assertion and marking a position. And then even in the Dit Karatid, it seems that's what I find so perplexing because with Varda, but so fascinating, is she certainly doesn't toe any kind of single political line, but in the Dit Karatid, where it's very much making us aware of the different roles that the naked female ornament on the building plays in relation to what the male plays. So I think we do get in her work often a very sensitive investigation of gender roles, often highlighting inadequacies and the position of women. But it's not, I don't think it's a consistent, let's say, position, or it's a complicated position. I'm not sure. Which is why I think it's important to try to think it through, in its implications. Just more food for thought.
Thank you. Yeah, I think there's a lot more thinking that we can still continue to do in relation to those positions and how that manifests itself in the other films. I mean, even to come back to Les Fiancées du Pont MacDonald, watching it this time, I really felt that the whole doll thing, which, you know, maybe is kind of funny, but also disquieting and uncomfortable, precisely because it says, you know, this is how women have been portrayed in cinema, as dolls, you know, as passive dolls, and it's funny and all the rest of it, but at the same time we suddenly see that quite clearly, you know, really in a really exaggerated way. So I think there's the making visible is part of this, you know, it's kind of, she exaggerates and suddenly it clicks into focus, you know. Definitely. And the men are kind of predators, but then by having Godard as this kind of Buster Keaton character, he's also sort of, you know, not a kind of hyper masculine male either.
Yeah, I mean, if I may chime in just for a second, for your information, 2 weeks ago when Varda was here, she gave a series of press interviews and the issue of feminism and politics came up, and she categorically stated, "I was born a feminist, and I've always been a feminist." So whatever you think my positions or attitudes are, that's basically the vantage point from which I work. But if I may, I would like to come back to the point you raised, where you said, you know, those politics are sort of disquieting because they're taking the bite out of the contradictions of modern society, if you will. Mark brought up Le Bonheur, and Varda herself said about Le Bonheur, the idea behind Le Bonheur is that everyone's unique and everyone's replaceable. And this to me seems important and politically relevant, because what she addresses is one of the fundamental contradictions of modern political theory, the contradiction between individuality and equality. You know, that's one of the big tensions in all modern political theories, that, you know, democratic societies are supposed to be built on the principle of equality, but there also needs to be space for the development of individuality. And, you know, modern mass societies tend to eliminate individuality, but we all strive for individuality. We try to become distinct individuals. And here comes Agnès Varda and says, well, doesn't really matter. It's true, you know, we're all unique, but it's also true we're completely replaceable. Let's move on. And that, in a way, is a massive provocation, you know, to refuse to carry on the metaphysical ballast, if you will, the metaphysical weight of that particular social and political contradiction. And I am slowly coming to, you know, adopting the position that maybe her political force lies in deflating certain accepted truth about the constitution of modern societies. And she does it in a poetic or narrative way. I mean, she does not claim to be a philosopher or a political theorist. She does not claim to present a systematic argument, but there are always moments or points in her films where she addresses these issues and comes up with completely surprising and, I think, very unconventional insights.
I think she really uses the medium of cinema as something that can sustain contradiction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can have competing ideas that don't mesh, that don't settle in one image or in one sequence. So, yeah.
I mean, when we watched and discussed Cleo, the topic of colonialism and the awareness of the Algerian War, of course, came up.
Yeah.
Because there's the radio broadcast. And then there are the masks. And I actually specifically asked her about the masks because I wanted to know if there was any kind of, you know, back political idea or something. And she just said, those, you know, there are several stores in that street that sell these masks, and she's afraid, and those are her reflections of her fear. So again, she's trying to deflate any kind of...
She loves to say about Cleo that everything's kind of just there by chance, and that, you know, Corinne Marchand just happened to walk past Rivoli 2, you know, the funeral parlor shop, and it's all just chance. But at the same time, it's there in the...
The film completely sustains a reading of Cleo as an anti-colonial text.
Mm.
So, but sorry, I shouldn't be talking so much. More questions.
Can I just come back to your first question?
Yes, please.
Because something occurred to me afterwards, just thinking about this idea of couples, and you kind of compared Jacques Demy and Varda to Elsa and Aragon. And this is something that she does herself when she's interviewing Annette Messager and Christian Boltanski. She kind of compares those three couples as these kind of creative couples.
Godard and Corinna is another one.
Godard,
it's a lifelong obsession.
Yeah, so but these couples are all really interesting. So I didn't like to mention it before the viewing, because I think it's good to see it kind of without this knowledge, maybe you knew already, but as soon as Elsa died, I think it was in 1975, Aragon came out as gay. So, you know, that obviously with Jacques Demy as well, who was bisexual, you know, there's actually more of a parallel there even than we could think. And all this stuff about Mayakovsky, who is sort of, one reading of that film is that Aragon is sort of haunted by this imposing tall figure of this Russian poet who may or may not have had a love affair with Elsa's sister, but was he also in love with Elsa, you know? But then another reading of that is Mayakovsky as this figure of desire, you know, for Aragon, which emerges only once you have this knowledge, which wasn't available at the time the film was made. You know, that those kinds of tensions in the couple are also present in Varda's work, I mean, and somehow present in that film, even though she probably didn't have any knowledge about that. It didn't, you know, that it wasn't kind of meaningful in that way at the time. But somehow that the idea that a heterosexual couple is not this kind of simple conte de fées fairy tale, that there's always, it's always more complicated than that. I think we already see that in the film, even without that knowledge.
Exactly. I mean, in Opéra Mouffe, there is also a third.
Yeah.
Part of the couple, there's the male observer, and it's not clear who he is desiring.
Yeah,
maybe him, maybe her.
Yeah, Yeah, so actually these, I mean, and you could say also even in Les Fiancés de McDonald's, again, it's not just, there isn't just one couple, there are all these different possible configurations of couples that you get as well, and substitutions.
Yes, please. Just wait for the microphone, because you're being taped.
Here, I mean, I need to wait, definitely. Okay. So this is a question from a non-cinema expert, and I'm just intrigued to know how Varda's films have progressed since 2003.
Okay, she's increasingly, basically she made the 2008 autobiographical film Les Plages d'Agnès, and really since then she's become what she calls a fine artist. She says she calls herself a plasticienne now. And she actually situates herself as having sort of three phases of her career, when she was a photographer before making her first film, La Pointe Courte, then becoming a filmmaker, and now being in the realm of fine art. It's interesting because that often involves filmmaking in some way, or like we were talking about with the Widows of Noirmoutier, with these installation screens. She does lots of installation work. She's going to do this project, which will be a film and a series of installations with this street artist JR. She has made one short film recently called Les Trois Boutons, The Three Buttons, which she made with, it's a very interesting film, she made it with or for some series of films funded by Miu Miu, I think it was, or one of the big fashion houses, and it had to have a dress in it, and so she, you know, basically you can watch it online and you can see how she dealt with the fact that she's dealing with having to get money for her funding. So something she often talks about is the fact that film is always funded, that money always comes from somewhere to make these films. She tries not to hide that, but expose it. And also the fact that this is the realm of fashion. This is a realm of beauty. It's exciting, it's glamorous, but it's also part of the patriarchy and traditions of misogyny. And so she has this enormous giant dress that threatens to overwhelm this young woman who kind of sets out on a journey of discovery against the backdrop of this overwhelming dress that would threaten to engulf her. So that's a recent film that she made, I think, last year. Anything else I should say about how it's developed since 2003? That's quite
pretty comprehensive. Yeah. But may I ask why you chose 2003 as the cut of year?
Simply because that was the date of Le Lion Volatile.
Right, yeah. It also happens to be the year when she first started to venture into installation work. She was invited to contribute an installation to an exhibition at the Fondation Cartier. And since then, she's continued to do installations. So, if you're interested in her installation work, she has a big show on at the Musée de d'Ixelles in Brussels, which lasts until the end of May. So you have one more month. It's 2 hours by train from here. So that's a nice weekend trip.
Envious.
She would very much appreciate if you went there. And
she would, you know, I'm sure when she was here, she was promoting it.
Yeah. I mean, we tried to bring some installation work concurrent with the series here to Frankfurt, but it, for various reasons, didn't fit into the scheduling of the other museums.
I'm actually convinced that she must have actually produced and made Le Lion Volatile well before 2003. I mean, it's slightly confusing because there are Franks. So there were no Franks, right, in 2003. So either this is some part of the strange sort of estrangement of the city, or it was made in 99.
Also the cars.
Mm.
They're old. They're definitely mid-90s car.
I think 99, something like that. But she shot that in with no sound, with no direct sound. So it's a silent film. And when you know that, I mean, the effort of that, she says she loves it, putting in all the Foley effects and the sounds of the ball bouncing and things. She says she loves it. There's a big, big job there.
Yeah.
Yeah. if there are no any other questions, we say thank you very much for this great evening. Isabel McNeil, thanks for your lecture.
Thank you for having me and for all your questions.
And also to Vincent Seliger, of course. Und für Sie der Hinweis, in zwei Wochen geht's weiter und dann kommt Kate Inns zu uns. Sie wird über Porträts von Paris auch reden, aber das anhand von Daguerreotype. Ein ganz, ganz spannender Film von 1976. Ihnen guten Nachhauseweg und bis hoffentlich bald wieder. Tschüss.